He touched me. Oh, he touched me. And now there's joy that floods my soul. Hello, dear friends. Pastor Dan here. You know, I do hope that each and every one of you had a wonderful Christmas and a holiday season. And I have a prayer going out there that our little Christmas things we did for you were a blessing to you and uplifting for that season. Now, as always, I'm grateful for each of you for joining with me today as we gather together around God's Word. The only Word, as I always say, the only Word of truth. I want to welcome you who are joining us for the first time. And dear friends, if you're blessed, if you're uplifted, even challenged by our study today, then I invite you to go to that little like button and press it and subscribe. That way you'll always know when we're going to be having a new study. And by the way, while you're there, you might want to press the invite button. Invite a friend, invite a family member. For that matter, invite a former friend. You never know what joy you might bring into their hearts as we encounter together the ever infallible, the ever unveiling truth of God's sacred and holy word. Now today, most likely because of in my heart, I feel it's sorely needed with everything that's going on. I felt led by the Holy Spirit to bring a message to you kind of based around Genesis chapter 1, the first four verses. And if I were to give this little study a title, I think it would probably be along the lines of Happy New You. So while you're turning to Genesis chapter 1, I want to give you just a little bit of background. Now, the English title Genesis comes from the Greek translation of the Old Testament, known as the Septuagint. Genesis means origins. The Hebrew title comes from the Bible's very first word translated in the beginning. Genesis serves to introduce the Pentateuch, which, as you know, is the first five books of the Old Testament. Now, the influence of Genesis in Scripture is demonstrated by the fact that it's quoted over 35 times in the New Testament. And there's literally hundreds of referrals to it appearing in both Testaments. The storyline of salvation, in fact, begins in Genesis chapter 3. Now, the author does not identify himself, but both the Old Testament and the New ascribe authorship to Moses, which, as you know, is the author of the Pentateuch in general. Anyway, so the storyline of salvation, as I said, you will find in Genesis chapter 3. Now, Genesis was written after the Exodus of 1445 B.C., and of course, Moses being the author, it had to be done before his death in 1405 B.C. Now, the initial setting is eternity past. And then, as we come forward in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, and chapter 2, verse 7, we see creation's ultimate act in God breathing the life of breath of life into a lump of dirt or dust to be fashioned in his image. Now, God made mankind the crowning point of his creation to be his companions, who would enjoy having fellowship with him, and he with them to bring glory to his name. And that's where a happy new you comes into play. So going to our text in Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 through 4, dropping to verse 26, and then chapter 2, verse 7, we read, "In the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void. Darkness was on the face of the deep. The Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And then God said, 'Let there be light,' and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good." Going on to verse 26, "Then God said, 'Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness.'" Chapter 2, verse 7, "And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, breathed into his nostril the breath of life. Man became a living being." Now, someone once said that all truth is parallel. So today we're going to take a look at the beginning of creation and what I see as this parallel seen in fallen humanity. We will then proceed to look at three aspects that make up a happy new you. Now, in the Scripture, God is revealed to us through 12 revelations of his name. Today, we're going to take a look at the first of the 12. And you need to understand that this name that we'll see today is used in our text as not so much a revelation of God as it is a presentation of God. So in verse 1, we read, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." Now, that word beginning gives our little finite minds a reference point. It's kind of like saying, here is the story of God's creation of the heavens and the earth. And you might find it interesting to know, the Hebrew word used for God has two parts. First, you have El, which means mighty or strong. It's used for any reference to God, including Almighty God, El Shaddai. And after El, you have Ohim. The Ohim gives the word a plural ending. And thus, in the Hebrew, it indicates more than one. In the Hebrew, in fact, Genesis 1 and 1 could accurately be translated Bereshit Elohim bara et hashamayim et haaret, meaning, in the eternal past, gods, remember, Elohim is plural, gods brought out of nothing the heavens and the earth. And so the first revelation of the name of God is Elohim. Now someone might say, wait a minute, are you saying there's more than one God? To which I would emphatically respond, no, absolutely not. Because when you consider Elohim, you must do so in the light of the Jewish Shema, the basic confession of faith in Judaism, as expressed in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4, where it reads, Hear, Shema, O Israel, the Lord Jehovah, our God Elohim is one. So in reading that, you need to know that the word used for one does not have a numerical meaning. It refers to unity. So in Genesis, you have the first biblical reference to the Trinity of God, who created the Trinity of man. It is as Genesis 1 verse 27 tells us, and God, Elohim, created man in his own image. In the image of God, Elohim created them. He created him. Male and female, he created them. Now again, in your private reading, you need to know that wherever this name is used in Scripture, it's in some way connected to creation or authority, power, greatness, dominion, and even glory. And every time it's used, we find these attributes declaring who God is. So you'll want to remember the name Elohim, as used here in Genesis 1, is not so much a revelation of God as it is a presentation of God. So first of all, there's God, there's Elohim, and you must make him first in your life. Only from the acknowledgement of Elohim will the actions begin to unfold and develop in your life that will produce fellowship with him and a prayer life, which is nothing more than a deeper fellowship with him. And then you need to know that whenever you see the name Elohim, it is always, don't forget, always an act. It's never in relationship. An act of authority, an act of power, an act of creation, and so on. So never forget, your acknowledgement of Elohim will cause the actions in your life that produce relationship with eternal returns. So, in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, we read, In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. And the parallel truth to that is you. Elohim created you. He created your life. Now, it may not be so much as you have chosen to live it, but as it is truly is in his image. All of humanity is created in his image. The problem is your life, your true spiritual nature is lost in the fall of humanity. And according to Colossians 3, you are dead, spiritually speaking. And your life, your true life is hid with Christ in God. And according to Genesis 1 verse 2, the earth was without form and it was void. And darkness was upon the face of the deep. Now, the words without form and void express the concept of chaos. The Hebrew indicates a wasteland, a desolate place. It suggests the earth was unfinished and empty. So the parallel is your life without the recognition of Elohim and the power and authority that resides in that name. Without him, your life is desolate or alone. It is, as the Hebrew indicates, worthless, but worthless in the sense that it appears without apparent godly purpose or design. Then that word darkness finds its parallel in the darkness of sin. Without Elohim's creative activity in your life is an empty, complete spiritual darkness, lost to sin and its dire consequences. Then there's the word deep. It describes the earth's water-covered surface before dry land appeared. and from the depths of this sea of water came dry land and life. And so the parallel truth is that even from the depths of the darkness of a life without Elohim can spring forth newness of life. So let's see what happens when the Holy Spirit of God comes on the scene. We see in Genesis 1, verse 2, as it continues, "And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters." Now that word "moved" has the meaning of hovering or brooding. There's actually, you could say, an incubation process taking place here. The Spirit of God is moving while the elements of the lifeless earth, they remain stoic, remain passive, awaiting their command, awaiting the ability to receive and act on the Word of God. And when the Holy Spirit comes into your life, a new creation takes place. It is as 2 Corinthians 5:17 tells you, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things, that old dead nature, old things have passed away. And behold, all things have become new, and that is your nature has become new. Your true hidden life has become reborn, and the Holy Spirit broods over you with creative activity. He protects you just as he did the earth, to respond to God's spoken word, his command. We see in verse 3 of chapter 1, "And God said, let there be light, and there was light." Light is what most clearly reveals and approximate God's glory. It is, as 1 John 1 and 5 tells you, God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. So light illuminates, light reveals, and it makes all else known. Without this light, you will remain in spiritual darkness. With this light, Genesis 1 and 4 takes place in your life, where it reads, "And God saw the light, that it was good. And God," still Elohim, "divided the light from the darkness." You need to know, in the Hebrew, the word "good," it has the meaning of that which is happy, as in a happy new you. It applies to something that is beneficial, aesthetically beautiful, morally righteous, and of ultimate value. What appeared to have no value now has ultimate value. Elohim makes and marks a difference, a dividing line, if you would, between the darkness that was in your life and the light that he now imparts to your life. And he calls it good. And you'll note from this point on that the earth was made ready for the rest of creation's story. And that's just the way it is with you. Once the Holy Spirit comes upon your old nature, bends to incubate the new, the light of Elohim enables you to see the things of God and to grow with understanding in your true nature into the image of God, the image of Elohim. In body, soul, and spirit, you are ready to be a happy new you. Now, I'm sure that like me, over the last few days, you've probably had many people say to you, "Happy New Year!" But I don't know about you, but no one has ever yet said to me, "Happy New You." It's always, "Happy New Year." So, while you may have watched what's left of our former New Year celebrations, while it may not have seemed as festive as usual, the reality is that wherever people could, they celebrated with all their shouting, their partying, their drinking, and carrying on. After it was all said and done, thousands went to sleep on New Year's Eve, only to awaken to the same old burdens and fears of 2020. And because liquor stores are considered essential to our well-being, they had the added pleasure of a hangover to start the new year with. Listen, there was no magic hour at midnight to suddenly usher in utopia, not even a socialistic utopia. Happy New Year, listen, Happy New Year will not necessarily equate to a happy new you, but a happy new you will always equate to a happy new year. In the natural, it's pretty hard to tell what brings happiness. Certainly, poverty and wealth both have failed. So, what are the three aspects of a happy new you? What makes a happy year? Happy New Year. What makes a year happy? For something really new, you might want to consider the new birth. According to John chapter 3, verses 3 through 5, it's not a matter of your opinion about it. The new birth is really a matter of necessity. It's essential. For Jesus said, most assuredly, emphatically, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Meaning he just absolutely cannot understand the things of the kingdom of God. And that's to be understood because the scripture tells us the natural man cannot receive the things of God. They're foolishness to him because they're spiritually discerned. And so as Jesus was talking to a religious man named Nicodemus, Nicodemus said unto him, well, how can a man be born when he's old? Surely he can't enter a second time to his mother's womb and be born. And Jesus answered, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. And so that born of water, that which is flesh, he said, is flesh. That which is spirit is spirit. You must be born again. Spiritual rebirth is essential. Many people find their life just so painful, especially with all we've gone through in last year. They just dream of the opportunity of just starting over again. If I could only do it again, I'd do that so many things different. Well, Happy New Year. The good news is, you can. You must be born again. You have to understand that being born again is not making New Year's resolutions. If you made a full page of resolutions and you kept all of them, you would still come up short. It would only be the same old you making the same old tired efforts to be a better person. And in your efforts to be a better person, Scripture reminds you in Isaiah that the righteousness of man, all the good deeds that we can do, is nothing more than filthy rags to God. Because there's only one righteousness that he wants to see upon you and in your life. Scripture says that God made him who knew no sin, Jesus, to be sin for us. Why? That we might be made the righteousness of God in him. That's the righteousness that God wants to see in your life. It's not your efforts. It's not your New Year's resolutions that are never fulfilled anyway. But the greatest resolution that you can make this new year is your resolve to heed the words of Jesus. Come, come unto me. John 1 and 12 tells us, when by faith one makes the decision to accept his invitation, we see it says, to as many as received him, Jesus, he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name, who were born not of the blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. You must be born again. And when you are, you're assured of a happy new you, with a whole new outlook, a whole new perspective on life, and a new walk to get you through it. Ephesians 5, verses 1 through 16, talks about this new walk, and you'll want to read it for yourself. You find that this new walk is a walk of love, because verse 1 of chapter 5 says, be imitators of God as dear children, and walk in love, as Christ also has loved us and has given himself for us. So you'll find that this is a walk also in light. Remember, the darkness was dispelled by the light of Elohim. In verse 8 of Ephesians 5, we read, you were once darkness, but now you're light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. And you'll find that this is a walk of in wisdom. In verse 15 of chapter 5, we're told, see that you walk very carefully, not as unwise men, but as wise. From Romans 13, verses 12 to 13, you'll find that this is a walk of honesty. Put on the armor of light. Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality and sensuality, not in strife and jealousy. Let us walk honestly. Only a new man can embark on this new walk. But as with any walk, you must be sustained with proper nourishment. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 through 3 tells you, rid yourself of all malice and all deceit, all hypocrisy, all envy and slander of every kind, and like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up in your salvation, now that you have tasted the kindness of the Lord. And lastly, you must practice this new walk. And the only way to do that is to consider yourself alive and dead at the same time. Someone might say, well, how do you do that? It is as Paul said in Philippians 1:21, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. So with the new birth, the new walk, you're well on your way to a happy new you, but there remains a new goal. In Philippians chapter 3, verses 8 through 14, Paul tells you, I count all things to be lost. They're nothing. He says, I count them to be lost in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith. And verse 10 reads, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death. Verses 13 and 14, I do not regard myself as having laid hold of it yet, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and reaching forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. And that word, this phrase, I press on, tells you there is a resistance. This is not an easy walk, but it's a wonderful walk. You press on through all resistance because you're the victor. In these few verses, you see that Paul, as you must willingly, even enthusiastically, gave up his past goals, goals of his old nature. He let go, as you must, of any sense of guilt over past sins and failures. Listen, you cannot hold onto the past and then reach for the future with the same hand. Even his personal victories, his personal achievements, according to Philippians 3:8, Paul counted it as nothing, nothing more than rubbish. Paul was willing, as you must be, to forget and lay aside everything, everything that might hinder his pressing on toward his new goal of achieving the prize of the upward or heavenward call of God in Christ Jesus. So, for a happy new you, you cannot and you must not do any less. So the question is, are you willing to forget the past? 2020 is over. You can't do anything about that anymore. It's gone. Are you willing to forget the past to claim the future and reach the new goal of a happy new you, enveloped in the light and fellowship of Elohim? It matters little what 2021 will bring you. It matters how you are yielded to the light of God, to Elohim, and the plan he has for your life, the purpose that he has for your life, and the lives that you can touch in that light and in that life, who also are facing the same consequences, the same sufferings and pain and fears that you have. But you know, Scripture tells us that perfect love, and only God's love is perfect, cast out all fear. And he loves you perfectly. You just have to receive that love and walk in that light. Jesus said in John 8:32, you shall know the truth. The truth shall make you free. Today, marking the first week of the new year, I shared the truth with you as Jesus declared it to be. In John 3, verses 3 and 5, he said, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. You'll never understand these wonderful truths without being born again. And except a man be born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. It's essential. And there are awful consequential results of neglecting this truth. If there's no new birth, there's no new you. You face this new year the same burdened down fears that gave you 2020 when you awoke to face a new year. No new walk. Your witness and your testimony, what you could give and offer to other people who are hurting, that's lost. No new goal? Your present and eternal rewards are forever lost. But you know, every coin has two sides. That's why in football, one side kicks and one side receives. Every coin has two sides. And acting on this truth brings positive results. Your new birth assures a happy new you, assures your salvation, your separation from the things of the world and unto God. Dedication are complete, and your new walk assures your new goals are realized by a happy new you for the glory of God. So today, as I close, I wish each of you happy new you. And I leave you to consider the words of Paul to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6, where it says, "For God," the Greek is theos, and by the way, the Greek is the equivalent to the Hebrew Elohim, theos, or Elohim. Elohim, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. And beloved, he has done all of this for a happy new you. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the possibilities that it offers us, if only we'll heed it. What better way to live than to hear your truth? For you are the way, dear Lord. You are the way, the truth, and the life. No better way, no greater truth, no better life than what you have to offer us to come through this new year with. And so, dear friend, if you're out there, if you're starting 2021, and you have this little fear and this trepidation, I remind you, perfect love casts out fear. If you don't know this Jesus who I've been sharing with you, then I invite you to ask him to come into your life and take it over. Rid that old nature. Give birth to that new nature so that you can face this new year as a happy new you. If that's you this today, then I'd ask you to just join with me in this prayer. Father God, I thank you for loving me so much that you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus, to be my Savior, to be the Lord of my life. And now I surrender my life to his Lordship. I ask you, Jesus, come into my life, take control of my life, that I might walk in newness of life. I promise I will walk with you. Dear friend, I hope today's study has been a blessing to you. And if that prayer was your prayer today, then please know and believe that in as much as you've surrendered your life to Jesus, as much as you've invited him to come in, take control as Lord and Savior of your life, that you can walk with him in 2021. Jesus has a promise for you. And you can see it in Revelation chapter 3, verse 21, the last book in the Bible, where he says, "Listen, listen, I stand at the door and knock." That's the door of your heart. If any man, any person hears my voice or my word and opens the door as you have, I will come into him and dine with him and he with me. And dear friend, that speaks of a rich, ever-increasing fellowship with Jesus. It only grows sweeter as the days and yes, even as the years go by, and as you immerse yourself into the Word of God and the fellowship of prayer. So with that in mind, I hope you'll join with us next time as we come once again and gather together around God's Word. Because as I always say, I believe that Father God has something special for us. But until then, God bless and bye-bye.